A very good afternoon to all the students who are present today to attend the online lecture for third year BCom semester 5 for the subject business administration. I warmly welcome one and all. Now students, you already have attended the previous lectures for BA, where you very well know that we had started and we had discussed the entire chapter number 1 of unit 1 that talks on financial management. In today's lecture, we shall be first revising whatever we have done earlier for chapter 1. There is a small quiz that I have put in the lecture that will test your knowledge as to how much you have understood from the chapter. And later on, we begin with the second chapter of unit 1 that talks on financial planning. So students, very quickly go through the topics that have been discussed. It would be a quick revision for everyone. In first chapter, I had begun the discussion with what do you mean by financial management? So we have understood that financial management was managing the finance. When I say we are managing the finance, we had to decide as to how the funds will be raised at a minimum cost and how it will be utilized optimally in the business. So says the definition, that it is raising of adequate funds at the minimum cost, but you are using them the most effectively and optimally in the business enterprise. We had understood the importance of financial management. We had revised the same in the previous lecture as well. I hope you are clear with the same. So students, do you remember the two approaches to the finance function? So yes, the first was the traditional approach and the second one was the modern approach. So do you remember why traditional approach was narrow and why the modern approach was wider in its scope? So there was something that was not covered in the traditional approach, but was covered and was studied in the modern approach. What was that, my dear students? So in the traditional approach, we were concerned only with one thing, that was the raising of funds at a minimum cost. But did we consider the optimum utilization of the same? No. But the same thing was considered in the modern approach. So we can say that the modern approach covered not only the decision of raising the funds, but also using them optimally. So we had discussed the traditional and the modern approach. You can see the three decisions that have to be taken under the modern approach of financial management. We had also studied the comparison, the difference between both the approaches. I hope you are clear by now. So in the previous lecture, you may remember that we had done with the last two topics of the chapter, that was the classification of finance function. I explained to you that the finance function could be classified in two broad categories. One, being the executive finance function and the other being the incidental finance function. So students, these were your executive finance functions. Quickly, I'll give you an overview about the same, that when a finance manager is performing the executive finance function, he's paying attention to number one, financial planning, where he will estimate the fund requirements so that he can decide as to how much funds needs to be raised for the organization. Number two, he has to decide the asset management policy. That is to say, after the funds have been raised, where will it be invested, whether in the fixed assets or whether in the current assets. Number three, when everything has been decided, you will have to decide the sources of finance. And we are talking about the external sources of finance, whether a commercial bank, whether a shareholder, whether a debenture holder, whether any insurance or financial company, etc. So those things have to be determined. Number four, When everything decided, then the finance manager will work for the negotiation of obtaining the funds. By negotiation, we had understood that he has to work for the fulfillment of the formalities in order to raise the money from the outside sources. That is to say, even if a loan has to be taken, the finance manager will have to accomplish the necessary formalities required. Once we have decided the fund requirement, we have decided the sources of funds, we have decided where we shall invest the funds, then comes your point number five, where you have to also decide about where the net profit will be distributed. So students, do you remember how the net profit had to be distributed? So it could either be distributed as payment of dividend to the shareholders. That is to say, the shareholders who have invested their hard-earned money in your business, you can repay them in the form of dividend, or it can be plowed back or retained back in the business itself, that we commonly know as the retained earnings or the plowing back of profit. The next you see, we need to also control the cash flow or control the financial performance, meaning to say, the finance manager will have to compare the standards that had been established for the raising of funds and the utilization of funds with the actual raising and actual utilization of the same. He needs to compare both the things so that he can control both the cash inflow and the cash outflow. Moving on, students, we had also discussed about the incidental finance function in the previous lecture. So you can quickly go through the incidental finance functions. It could be supervising over the cash receipts. So I hope you remember, I had told you in the previous lecture as to which component constitutes the majority or the maximum of the cash receipt. So it was your sales. So as a finance manager, you will have to pay attention over the cash receipts to see that the money is realized from the sales in time, whether cash or whether credit sales. The risk of bad debts should be reduced to a minimum level. Next was cash disbursements, where he has to pay attention on the distribution of cash also, that is payment of the liabilities as in when they occur. Number three, it could be keeping the record of cash. When I say record, it is record of cash inflow and cash outflow. Thereafter, to tally the cash and bank balances, that was by preparing a bank reconciliation statement. We have discussed all about that. Supervision of bills. So which were the two bills? It was the bill receivable and the bill payable. As a manager, he has to see to it that the bills are paid in time. And also, if there is a bill receivable, the money should be received in time as well. Next, safeguarding the valuable papers. So I had explained to you that an organization might have some surplus cash that may be invested in some sort of assets. So those papers have to be preserved and safeguarded by a finance manager. Next could be the insurance policies if taken for the assets of the organization. So as a finance manager, he will also have to work for fulfilling the formalities, maybe asking for a claim or also preserving the insurance policies. Thereafter, keeping records of whatever transactions are taking place in the organization. Lastly, he also has to work for the preparation of reports. Could be a balance sheet, could be a P&L account and whatnot, so that it can depict the financial performance or the financial condition of every business enterprise. So I hope you are clear with the finance functions as well. And the last topic that we had completed in the previous lecture was importance of finance function. Have a quick glance at the points. So I hope you are clear, completely clear after this quick revision of your chapter number one of unit one, that is financial management. Now, students, to test your knowledge a bit, after having studied chapter 1 for 3 lectures now, I have just put a small quiz for you. So you may please see the questions and try to answer those to test whether you have understood the concept of financial management or not. So let us begin with the first question. Raising of adequate funds at the minimum cost and using them effectively in business is known as. So yes, the answer is financial management. Question number 2. Which approach of finance function is concerned with both raising and effective utilization of funds? So you have understood 2 approaches. Which of them is concerned with both the things? All right. So it is your modern approach. The 3rd one, please read it and try to answer. Which approach of finance function is the outsider looking in approach? Now, those who had attended the lecture will only be able to answer this question. So the approach whose other name is also the outsider looking in approach is nothing but the traditional approach. I had given you the reason for the same. Because in traditional approach, we are only considering the raising of funds, that too from the outsiders particularly. And so says the name, outsider looking in approach. All right, number 4 for you. Supervising cash receipts, bills, valuable papers, preparing reports, etc. are the types of which finance function? We have just revised the same in this lecture as well. So I hope you get the answer. It is your incidental finance function. And the last one for you, please read it. Financial planning, asset management policy, negotiating for obtaining the funds, distribution of net profit, etc. are the types of which finance function? So it is your executive finance function. I hope with this quiz and with the revision, you are by far clear with the first chapter on financial management. As I said, without any further discussion, without any further ado, we shall also begin with the next part, the next chapter of the unit that talks on financial planning. So, let us now begin with the second chapter, that is financial planning. In the first lecture of BA, I had given you an idea about the syllabus of third year BCom, semester 5 BA. I had told you that the unit 1 covers weightage of 50% that talks on financial management. But it has 5 chapters to it, or I can say there are 5 parts associated to it. We have done the first one, that is financial management. And today we begin with the second part or the second chapter of Unit 1, that is your financial planning. So let us begin with the same. Students, before we begin with what do you mean by financial planning, can you get an idea about what did we mean by planning? All remember about the managerial functions. And if you remember them, the very first function you might have studied was nothing but planning. Why was planning so important and such an important function even in management? It was because of the simple reason that planning is done for future. and the future is quite uncertain. In order to avoid the risk of uncertainty that one can face in future, planning is done well in advance. So the same planning is required even for the finance being used in the organization. Now you would say, why should finance be planned, or why should we undertake financial planning in an organization? Can't we just raise the funds when required, and can't we just use the funds when we want to do that? So the answer is no. If you don't do an effective financial planning, the result would be that either the organization faces scarcity of funds, that is, it will have a shortage of finance, or it will have surplus of funds on hand. Let me tell you that both the situations are not welcomed by any organization. When I say that there is a shortage of funds or scarcity of finance, it is not good, because we know in absence of funds, the work cannot be performed. Ultimately, the targets won't be achieved. Secondly, if I say that there are surplus funds being there in the organization, there is excess of funds. Again, it is not good, because I told you that funds are raised at a cost. But if those funds are not required by the business, it will be merely blocked in the business. You have paid the cost for raising it, but on the other hand, you are not getting the sufficient return by utilizing it, because it was not required by the business. And that goes without saying now that financial planning is of utmost importance in any business organization. And now the second question. When I am saying that we are planning the finance, or we are undertaking financial planning, and it is very important, then what are we actually doing while planning the finance? So students, we are actually estimating the fund requirement of an organization. That is to say, we shall estimate how much funds are actually required by an organization. So based on that, one can decide as to from which sources the funds can be raised. Because once you know how much fund is required by an organization, you can definitely work for its procurement. So after this discussion, let us have a look on the meaning of financial planning. So as I said, it is the process of estimating the fund requirements of a firm and determining the sources of funds. You need to first estimate how much fund is required by an organization. And once that is done, you can even determine the sources from where you can raise the same. Another definition that talks on the same two things, that it is concerned with the amount of capital to be raised for the present and the future requirements of business. See, there could be a number of objectives that a business wants to achieve. Could be the short-term objectives, could be the long-term objectives. That is, it could be just meeting with the day-to-day operations, or it could be to work for the expansion and development. Whatever the case may be, you require finance. So the same finance is to be estimated, and thereby it is to be decided as to from which securities, which sources the fund, the capital will be raised. So I hope you are clear with the very basic meaning of financial planning. We move further to the objectives of financial planning. Now, few objectives we have already discussed as to why financial planning is of utmost importance. To name a few, we just discussed that because future is uncertain and you don't want to enter into a situation where you are facing scarcity of funds, or you are facing excessive funds that is even not required in the organization. So in order to avoid such situations, you need to undergo financial planning. Also, it is required to achieve the objectives, the goals of an organization. So let us discuss some more objectives. The first one, the very important one, that one needs to ensure the supply of sufficient funds to run the business smoothly. When I say we are doing financial planning, at least we will know that we have estimated the fund requirement and we have raised that much fund. So in future, while we are performing the business, while we are running our business, we won't face the scarcity of funds. We would always have the adequate funds, the sufficient funds that are required to run the business. Imagine a situation where business wants to do production, but it is facing shortage of funds. The production would come to a standstill, ultimately the profits getting declined. So financial planning is of utmost importance for the same. You need to understand point number two and point number three together. That is, financial planning is required to determine the financial policies. Which policies? So for raising and the use of funds. As I said, it begins itself with the estimation of fund requirement and thereby deciding from where would you raise the same. So financial planning is required to determine the same. And thirdly, once you have determined the policies, you also need to work for the implementation of the same. Number four, financial planning is required to estimate the cash requirements. When I say cash requirements, it is again to decide as to what shall be the fund requirement for a business, thereby creating liquidity. Now, this thing we have discussed even in chapter one. That every business wants to maintain enough liquidity, enough cash on hand, enough sources that can be converted to cash easily, so that whenever the liabilities occur in future, they can be paid off very easily. So financial planning is required to estimate this cash requirement. Number five, we have discussed already. Financial planning will reduce the risk of future uncertainties by peeping into the future. Now, this point you very well can associate with planning also. Similarly, when you are planning your finance, you do so that the future risk can be avoided or can be minimized to an extent. The changes will keep on taking place, and we know that it is a very dynamic environment. But at least if you have estimated your fund requirement, you can minimize and you can reduce the risk of future. So because you have already estimated the finance and the fund requirement at present, well in advance, it will help the organization from the future risk to come. Lastly, as you can see, it will create confidence in the management to meet the future liabilities. Because see, when we have done financial planning, when we have estimated already the fund requirements, and accordingly we have raised sufficient fund also, the management would always be confident that if the future liabilities occur, as in when they occur, they have the fund to meet with the same. So have a quick glance at all the objectives that we have discussed right now. We have discussed the definition of financial planning and the objectives as to why financial planning is required. All right, students, we move on to the next and probably the last topic for today's lecture. We are going to study on a very important topic pertaining to financial planning as to what are the factors which are affecting financial planning. A very important answer, but if you understand it thoroughly in today's lecture, you are done through. So please pay your keen attention for the same. We have understood that financial planning was to estimate the fund requirement and thereby deciding the sources from where you could raise the funds. But then the question comes, what are these sources of funds, or what are the sources from where you can raise the funds? So you should know that broadly the sources are classified into either the own funds, or it could be the borrowed funds. It could be equity shares, where the payment of dividend is not fixed and not compulsory. Or on the other hand, it could be the preference shares, where fixed dividend is to be paid compulsorily. You have the debentures, you have the loans taken from the banks, where again there is a fixed payment of interest to be made. So as an organization, one has to decide whether the funds will be raised from equity or whether it will be raised from the other borrowed funds. So the factors that you see above are all the factors which will decide, which will help a business to know whether to raise the funds from the equity shares or whether one should go for the debentures and the preference shares. So once you read every factor, just pay attention that you need to answer based on that factor, that whether the firm will raise the funds from own funds or from the borrowed funds. Let us begin with number one. It is the money market conditions. When I say money market conditions, we are talking about the economic conditions of either a boom period or a recession. Now, when I say there is a boom, there is prosperity phase going on in the economy, definitely the investors prefer more of income. They have an expectation of higher dividend, because of which they will invest more in the equity shares. While on the other hand, if the economy is facing depression, there is a recession phase going on in the economy, the investors prefer more safety rather than the risk, or rather than the income. And that is why they would be willing to invest more in the debentures or in the preference shares, where they can get a fixed interest or they get a fixed dividend. So meaning to say, based on the money market conditions, that is based on the boom period, the equity shares can be issued. And if the economy is struck with the times of depression, the organization can go for the issue of debentures or the preference shares. Number two, retaining control. Now, students, I hope you have studied this even in accounts, that equity shareholders possess a right, that is a voting right, that is not available to the debentures or to the other shareholders. So in case a business wants to retain the control with itself, it does not want to divide that controlling power with someone else, it should go in for the issue of debentures. But on the other hand, if they are ready with parting with the control, they are ready to invite the equity shareholders in the decision making. They are ready with the voting rights that will be given to the equity shareholders. They can raise the funds from the equity share capital. So as I said, based on the controlling power also, it will decide as to from where the funds will be raised. I repeat again, in case the control has to be retained by the business organization, they can go for debentures, they can go for the preference shares, because they do not have voting rights. On the other hand, if they don't want to retain the control, they can go from the raising of funds through equity shares. Number three, the nature of assets of the company. Now, the nature of assets is basically whether the business has enough assets to mortgage or not. When the business unit does not have fixed assets which are of a higher value and they cannot mortgage the same as well, then they should not issue the debentures, because as you know, debentures is a secured loan and one will have to mortgage the asset if the money has to be raised. So in that case, the business, the company should rely on the equity shares only. Otherwise, if they have enough assets and the assets are there to be mortgaged, they can go even raising of funds through debentures. Number four talks about the capital requirement. So when a business organization requires little capital, a larger amount is not required, then they can go for a single type of security also. Let us say the equity shares can be issued. But if a large amount of capital is required by the company, then it will be necessary to use different type of securities. Could be debentures, could be preference shares, etc. Next being the stability of earnings. Now, stability of earnings, or even the next point, the nature of business talks about that if the earnings are stable, if the company has stable earnings, regular earnings, the nature of business is such that they have a fixed and a regular income, then they can go for raising the funds through the issue of debentures or the preference shares, because they are to be paid fixed interest, they are to be paid fixed dividend, and if the company can afford the same, it has stable earnings for the same, then they can go for it. But in case the earnings are quite irregular, it is quite unstable, the nature of business is quite risky already, then it should go for the equity shares, because as we know, it is not compulsory to pay dividends to them regularly. I hope you are clear with all the factors. Moving to the last few factors that affects the financial planning is number seven, the cost of financing. Now, you should be familiar with one thing, that it is relatively, comparatively costlier to raise finance through the equity shares. It is because of the advertisement expenditure, the underwriting commission, the brokerage, and other expenses which are connected to it. So in that case, if that cost of financing cannot be borne, company can go for the debentures or for the other securities. Because to raise funds from equity is quite costlier as compared to the other sources of funds. So even that could be a factor affecting financial planning. The next is legal restrictions. So I hope you might have heard about SEBI, that is your Securities and Exchange Board of India. You have also heard about the Companies Act 2013. So even the legal restrictions that are imposed by these laws also governs a company and the sources from where it can raise the funds. As a company, it has to abide by the restrictions that are imposed by law, and then only decide as to from where the funds can be raised. Next, number nine is a very good point, which tells you about the attitude of investor and how even it can affect the source of fund. When I say attitude, remember two kinds of attitude. It can either be a risk taker attitude of an investor, or it could be a safety seeker attitude. When investor is willing to take the risk, he is a risk taker. He can go for the equity shares, because definitely it is a risky investment where dividends regularity is not assured. On the other hand, if they are safety seekers, they don't want to take risk, but they want safety, then they would go for the preference shares where they get fixed dividend, or they would go for the debentures where they get fixed interest. So even the attitude of investor affects the funds that can be raised and the sources from where it can be raised by a company. The next point that you see, number 10, taxation policy of the government. Now, again, accountancy students might have done one thing, that the interest to be paid on debentures, the fixed interest that company pays to the debenture holders, is considered to be a tax deductible expenditure. The tax benefit is received on the interest that is paid to the debentures. It is tax deductible. So when the company wants to take the benefit of taxation, wants to save itself from the tax pertaining to the interest, it can go for raising of funds through debentures, because such a benefit is not available in the other sources of finance. And lastly, the general level of interest rate, meaning to say when the interest rates on debentures or on the other sources of funds are already higher, they are already more, then it is better as a company to go for the equity shares or for the preference shares. But on the other hand, if the rate of interest is quite lower as compared to the dividend rate, then the company can go for raising the funds through debentures. So these were the factors that we studied for financial planning, or the factors that affect the source from where the money can be raised. I hope you were clear with the topics. To give you a quick recap of what we have done, so we revised the chapter 1, financial management, with a small quiz that you answered. We began with the second chapter of unit 1, that is financial planning, where you have understood with the meaning of financial planning. You have also understood the objectives of financial planning. Lastly, we also discussed with the factors that would affect financial planning, or which would affect the source from where the funds can be raised. I hope you are clear by the end of the lecture. Still, if you have any doubts, any queries, please put it, please comment it down in the Google Classroom of your respective class, and I shall be answering to all those doubts at the earliest. We meet in the next lecture again with further discussion on financial planning. Until then, thank you so much for the day. Happy learning.